decisions which we've loathed, which should have been at times at group meetings where cabinet members and others have been literally in tears at some of the decisions that we've had to take because they're the only options in front of us. You should join us in making the tough decisions because really, you don't have any other option either.
Councillor Jenny.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. It's not really a speech so much as responding to some of the items that have been raised. Okay, first of all, it's not a green idea to have to hold a referendum. This is one of the government's conditions that have been imposed upon us for, well, certainly since I've been elected. We're hamstrung by that. And I'm certain that had we not had that condition, then we would have been able to raise Council's Act incrementally over the last decade to have the positive effect have and slowly build up that council tax base. We don't have an option to get around that other than just saying, well, we won't do it then. And we want to make that decision to actually say that we would rather offer the choice. Anybody who reads Noam Chomsky will understand the way he describes the standard technique of privatisation. To defund, make sure things don't work, people get angry, and you hand it over to private capital. And this is the formula that the government is using in its direction with all of our public services, and such a local authority is one of them. The Mayor has stated on council tax that in future, council funding will be raised purely by local taxing. Council tax is half of that, and that business tax is the other. It, as Martin Cummins, Councillor Cummins pointed out, we will probably have to revisit this anyway. And if we can make small steps now, increase it by a small amount now, it all builds up over time. It is clear what the government is trying to do, to force local authorities to make the horrible decision so people think it's the local authority's fault. But we all in here know that where the real responsibility lies, and we should all be campaigning to get this government out. We have faith in the people of Liverpool to think collectively here. On the question of Brighton, they didn't try to go for a referendum because the opposition, Labour and Tories colluded to vote that down. I would think that's said it all. The council's tax support scheme, I understand, came in under budget this year. Now that could be a result of fewer people needing it. It can be a result of people coming out of unemployment, people getting into employment, people having the wage that suggests that they can afford to pay the council tax. We've also said in our amendment that some of the funds we would raise would go back into that support scheme, into the hardship scheme. We support a lot of the projects that have happened over the last decade. We certainly support things like renovating old properties, bringing them back into use. That makes such a huge difference to the community, and I've said that before. We think invest to earn, invest to save are brilliant ideas, bringing income in for the council to become an earner. Valuable resources. And the city's numbers are growing, they're slow, but we've noticed there's an increase in residents in the area and there's an increase in the council tax base. It is a slow progress, but people don't come to Liverpool and look at the council tax, they come to Liverpool because it's such a bloody smashing place to be and they're proud to live here and call it their home. The regressive element about council tax, which has been raised, the same argument he said, if we withdraw the collective spend on local services, the people who most need those services that we're trying to save are the people who are least likely to be able to afford it. It's why we work collectively, to provide collectively. Those same people then will be left without that service. They will either have to go to a private company or they'll have to pay more than they would have had to pay in the small increase in council tax that we're asking. In terms of neighbourhood fund, we love our neighbourhood fund, we don't get much, I think we get about 17 grand in St Michael's, but we've done constructive things with it and people are really grateful when they see those things happen. We wouldn't want to lose it ideally, but given what the other cuts to serious, incredibly valuable services like libraries, children's centres and all the rest that we've been threatened with over the last few years, we think that neighbourhood funding is actually the least worst option. In terms of the national living wage, we're going to need this extra increase that we can start building up even now. That will benefit us in the long term. So, in terms of our amendment, no doubt we reject it because it's an unpopular move, but we feel that actually there's sound reasoning for it. Thank you, Lord Mayor.
I've got no other speakers listed, so we're going to move to the vote on the amendment. Chief Executive.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Councillor Aspinall. Councillor Banks. Councillor Barrington. Councillor Beaumont. Councillor Bennett. Councillor Brandt. Councillor Brennan. Councillor Brown. Councillor Kane. Councillor Calvert. Councillor Castles. Yes. Councillor Connor. Yes. Councillor Corrigan. Yes. Councillor Crome. Yes. Councillor Dave Cummins. Yes. Councillor Martin Cummins. Yes. Councillor Dean. Yes. Councillor Adele Dowling. Yes. Councillor Brian Dowling. Yes. Councillor Foxley. Yes. Councillor Frankel. Yes. Councillor Francis. Yes. Councillor Roy Gladden. Yes. Councillor Ros Gladden. Yes. Councillor Blair. Yes. Councillor Hanratty. Councillor Hanson, yes. Councillor Harrison, yes. Councillor Herron, Councillor Hennigan, yes. Councillor Hirschfield, yes. Councillor Hunt, yes. Councillor Hughes, yes. Councillor Hurley, yes. Councillor Jennings, yes. Councillor Jones, yes. Councillor Erica Kemp, yes. Councillor Councillor Richard Kemp, yes. Councillor Kennedy, yes. Councillor Kent, yes. Councillor Knight, yes. Councillor Barry Kushner. Councillor Joanne Kushner.
Yes.
Councillor McCallie.
Yes.
Councillor McIntosh. Yes. Councillor McClendon.
Yes.
Councillor Mitchell.
Yes.
Councillor Moore.
Yes.
Councillor Morrison.
Yes.
Councillor Munby.
Yes.
Councillor Murray.
Yes.
Councillor Nicholas.
Yes.
Councillor Noakes.
Yes.
Councillor Norris.
Yes.
Councillor Anna Byrne.
Yes.
Councillor Rachel Byrne.
Yes.
Councillor Orr.
Yes.
Councillor Owen.
Yes.
Councillor Prendergast.
Yes.
Councillor Prince.
Yes.
Councillor Kadir.
Yes.
Councillor Radford,
yes.
Councillor Rainey,
yes.
Councillor Rasmussen,
yes.
Councillor Roberts, apologies,
yes.
Councillor Robertson Collins,
yes.
Councillor Robertson,
yes.
Councillor Rotherick,
yes.
Councillor Simon,
yes.
Councillor Small,
yes.
Councillor Spurrell,
yes.
Councillor Strickland, Councillor Sullivan,
yes.
Councillor Sung,
yes.
Councillor Jed Taylor,
yes.
Councillor Jackie Taylor,
yes.
Thomas,
yes.
Councillor Thomas, sorry. Councillor Walker,
yes.
Councillor Winston,
yes.
Councillor Wolfson,
yes.
Councillor Wood,
yes.
Councillor Woodhouse,
yes.
Lord Mayor.
The voting for the amendment was 4, 4, against 74, no abstention. The amendment is lost. We're going to the voting on the main motion now, Chief Executive.
I only just want to correct something around what the Greens said, really. And if you remember going back, and I'm giving you a bit of credit here in terms of you actually supported us in the fact that we didn't accept the Lib Dem Tory con of accepting the £2 million Eric Pickles money, because we knew it would have been lost in terms of the base budget going forward. So we did that, but we rejected the in terms of referendum proposal, because we didn't feel that at that time was right. And the fact of the matter is that, as Councillor Brand said, the opportunity for us, the only opportunity we have, is to grow our city, to grow its economy, and to strengthen it by creating jobs and creating opportunities and using that to protect the most vulnerable, not to actually use a regressive tax system that punishes the poorest, that actually targets the poorest, so we, you know, will continue to do what we're doing, not just now, but over the next few years too. And I hope everybody notes the report and welcomes the additional information.
Ready, Chief Executive.
Thank you. Councillor Aspinall. Councillor Banks. Councillor Barrington. Councillor Beaumont. Councillor Bennett. Councillor Brand. Councillor Brennan. Councillor Brown. Councillor Kane. Councillor Calvert. Councillor Castles. Councillor Connor. Councillor Corrigan. Councillor Crone. Councillor Dave Cummins. Councillor Martin Cummins. Councillor Dean. Councillor Adele Dowling. Councillor Brian Dowling. Councillor Foxley. Councillor Frankel. Councillor Francis. Councillor Roy Gladden. Councillor Ros Gladden. Councillor Glare. Councillor Hanson. Councillor Harrison. Councillor Herron. Councillor Hennigan. Councillor Hirschfield. Councillor Hunt. Councillor Hughes. Councillor Hurley. Councillor Jennings. Councillor Jones. Councillor Eric Kemp. Councillor Richard Kemp. Councillor Kennedy. Councillor Kent. Councillor Knight. Councillor Barry Kushner. Councillor Joanne Kushner. Councillor McCallie. Councillor McIntosh. Councillor McClendon. Councillor Mitchell. Councillor Moore. Councillor Morrison. Councillor Mumby. Councillor Murray. Councillor Nicholas. Councillor Noakes. Councillor Norris. Councillor Anne O'Byrne. Councillor Rachel O'Byrne. Councillor Hall. Councillor Owen. Councillor Prendergast. Councillor Prince. Councillor Kadir. Councillor Radford. Councillor Rainey. Councillor Rasmussen. Councillor Roberts. Councillor Robertson Collins. Councillor Robinson. Councillor Rothery. Councillor Simon. Councillor Small. Councillor Spurrell. Councillor Sullivan. Councillor Sung. Councillor Jed Taylor. Councillor Jackie Taylor. Councillor Thomas. Councillor Walker. Councillor Winston. Councillor Wolfson. Councillor Wood. Councillor Woodhouse. Councillor Goldman.
The voting is as follows: for the motion 76, against 3, no abstentions. The motion is carried. Thank you. Can I call on Mayor Anderson for item 6? Oh no. So item 6, Joe, Mayor Anderson.
Okay, just moving the annual pay policy statement.
Is that agreed?
Yes.
Again, item 7.
And then just moving, Lord Mayor, the discretionary council tax relief for the foster carers, please.
Is that agreed?
Yes.
Item 8.
Yeah, one urgent decision was taken during the last cycle of meetings, which is set out on page 224 of the agenda, Lord Mayor.
Are there any questions? Have been noted? Mayor Anderson?
Just one announcement from me, Lord Mayor, and then a comment to the Chief Executive and Assistant Solicitor. The announcement, of course, is what's already been announced, but what we are delighted to have achieved, and that is a £17 million investment in our sports facilities across the city, a deal that is absolutely envied by other cities across the country, one that provides new facilities for people across the city, in terms of young people, adults, boys and girls, across the whole city, a fantastic opportunity for us to develop grassroots football, which improves health outcomes for young people and everybody within the city. Also helps us in terms of giving kids things to do. It's not rocket science that when they've got things to do and the ability to do it, that that decreases antisocial behaviour. It means that the investment means that football can be played in inclement weather, where football is often put off because of snow, hail, rain, ice, waterlogged pitches. And this means that the new 3D pitches that are going to be introduced, as well as new brand new facilities, changing facilities, health facilities within those particular sites, are going to improve the offer for the people of this city. So it's really great news. I think the officers that have worked behind the scenes with Tim Moore and others, Wendy included, Wendy Simon, Ron, the whole team worked fantastically well. And I know Greg Dyke himself is thrilled with the achievement. So on behalf of the council, Ron, pass our best wishes on to everyone and say thank you for that investment. And of course, it's not something that is being universally welcomed. We've got the Fib Dems in the church board who've attacked it. And indeed, we've had an offer from one member of the duo to actually work with us, he says. I congratulate Councillor Kemp on her retirement, and I know that will be a great relief that she'll probably see less of the other part of her duo. But one of the things that, Lord Mayor, I want to challenge him on is that he claims that this will be a disruption for the people who live around the Erin Eccles fields in his ward. Well, the ward councillor here that acts in the interests of the residents there will be holding a public meeting with himself to discuss the Erin Eccles investment and how it will actually alleviate the problems that they face, because within the new site will be over 200 parking spaces, and it means that when teams miss out playing on a Saturday and Sunday, they can play under floodlights for a period that we will work with the residents to make sure they agree with that time period. So, in other words, it doesn't disrupt their lives. But, you know, Lord Mayor, I personally, and it's my challenge to the Chief Executive, really, and to the City Solicitor, I am getting absolutely sick and tired to the back teeth of the Liberal Democrats continually lying to people in this city. Yes, continually lying. I don't know whether he's scurried out of the chamber because he knew I was going to make these comments. But I have the latest hocus pocus that is going around, Lord Mayor. And as I say this with some restraint, really. You know, I'm absolutely disappointed, Chief Executive, and to you, City Solicitor, that this is allowed to be put out around our city with absolute lies and claptrap, which are frightening people into believing. We've got the fact that Labour's latest bright idea, bins to be collected once a month. Well, this council demands to know from you or from your officers who is leading the debate on introducing monthly bin collections into the city. I want to know. They have a right to know. The people of Churchward have a right to know. Who's lying? Is it you, or is it the city solicitor, or is it the person responsible for leading on this particular area, Ronald Denier? Or is it the Liberal Democrats? But someone's telling lies to the people of this city, and I'm no longer going to put up with it, because you have a responsibility, as I do as mayor of this city, to make sure that everybody is given the right information about what we're doing in this city. And I can go on with this leaflet. That's important for us to understand. It's telling us that we've rejected £10 million from central government. It's another Liberal Democrat lie that's frightening people to think that when we're facing austerity as severe as it is, that he's telling people we're giving that money back. And then he's talking about 18 acres of park that's being sold, parkland. Again, another Liberal Democrat lie. And so what are we going to do about it? This monthly bin collection service is an out-and-out lie that has to be corrected by this council. And I demand to know what you're going to do about it, or what the solicitor is going to do about it, because it is going out through doors and people are engaging in conversations with people, asking the question about, are we going to introduce a monthly bin collection? The same Liberal Democrat lies that told people in that area we were closing Allerton Library. The same Liberal Democrat lies told people we bought a building, the VAT building, for people to live on. When are we going to stop this? This isn't politics. This is lies, desperate lies to win votes that are impacting and frightening people within the city. And I demand to know what you as Chief Executive and what the City Solicitor are doing to a man who's being censured by this council for doing exactly that. What are we going to do about it? Because people out there are being fed this rubbish by him and his party that's lying to the people of this city.
I was going to ask if any members would like to ask the mayor a question, but seeing Councillor Kemp is back in the chamber, would you like to respond to some of the points made by the mayor?
I'm sorry, the agenda moved on a lot faster than I had thought, and as a relatively old person, I sit at the back so I can go to certain places quicker than others. Two items apparently came up, one while I was away. Perhaps I could ask the mayor, to explain his position on Heron Eccles. Because speaking on Radio Merseyside on Friday, he said two things which are contradictory. The first is, he said, and I have checked the transcript of this, there will be no more matches played at Heron Eccles under the new proposals than there have been to date. In which case, why did he also make the statement that he, in that, would still be putting floodlights on that pitch? And could I ask him a further question? If he's prepared to meet the residents now, why did his officers turn down an offer from myself and the local residents to discuss what is a very difficult area to redevelop? Because it's tied in by very dangerous roads from very dangerous junctions, and we're going to put floodlighting right next to people's homes. It's the only way you can develop that site. We want this development to go ahead. We offered from last October to do something about it, to try and get a meeting of minds so this could go ahead, but that offer from local residents and ourselves was totally rejected. Could he explain why?
Well, first and foremost, I don't believe a word you say. If today was, you told me it was Wednesday, I'd go by the Echo, and I don't very much believe what's in the Echo either. But I checked the date on that. That's the first point. You talk about what I said, and I stand by what I said on the radio. There is no intention to increase football matches in there. There's 115 teams signed up to play on Heron Echoes, and they will play their games in a normal way. What they won't do is have games cancelled. And what we will do is provide car park and inadequate spaces. And let me tell this to you, who's got a chip on his shoulder, Mr. Big Licks. You won't meet with me and the residents. I'll meet with the residents, with the ward council in that area, not with you, okay? I'll meet with the residents in that area, and we'll discuss and debate it. And the reason why we didn't involve anybody else in the debate and discussion, because the deal wasn't done. We only discussed it after we got it across the line and we signed it with the FA. You are not part of this administration. In fact, you weren't even part of the administration when it was run by the Liberal Democrats. You were chased out of the city, for Christ's sake, and everyone knows it. So get off your high horse. Answer the question, Chief Executive. What are we doing about the lies that he spoke around the city about the bins and the money that we've taken? It's got to be addressed. He's been censured by this council for his behaviour, and he needs dealing with, because there are lies that are frightening people. There is no intention to introduce monthly bin service in this city. You know it, I know it, and so do the officers know it. And somebody is telling lies, and I guess it's not you. And that only leaves me with one conclusion.
Lord Mayor, just to be absolutely clear on the issue about bins, there are no conversations, no suggestions, let alone any proposals for any changes to the bin service, which will move to a monthly form of bin collection. That matter has been brought to my attention before this evening. We have written to the councillor concerned, and a response is still awaited.
Lord Mayor, just that concludes my contribution under that. But I do want to say this, that immediately you get that, I want to see it, because I'm telling you, as mayor of this city, I will make the decision that people in this city are written to be pointed out that these are lies and it's not happening. And the cost should be borne out by the Liberal Democrats, because I'm sick and tired of us picking up and having to write to people because we have to address the lies and the smears that have been put out by the Liberal Democrats. We should be charging the Liberal Democrats or stop them using facilities within this city.
Yeah. If I might ask the Chief Executive a question, my Lord Mayor, as it's in vogue, I wonder if he could explain to me why a Freedom of Information request relating to Calderstones Park, which was submitted on the 16th of December, which the Information Commissioner's Office wrote to the Council at the beginning of February because it hasn't been answered, has still remains unanswered some 6 weeks after the legal time when it was supposed to be responded to.
Lord Mayor, with the greatest respect, can I just make a point here? That this isn't a question time for him to address council officers. This is a question time for him to ask me. And in response to that, I don't know, and I'm sure you'll get the response when the officers are ready. But let me point out that I understand and fully know what you're up to. Because you're trying to pretend that that is part of the park. Now, isn't it a simple fact, that the Beachley Riding Stables, the Model Railway and Calder Kids are not accessible to the public? Not accessible to the public. And every one of them organisations are absolutely thrilled with the fact that we are being innovative and providing them with new money to sustain them for the future. It's not you, because you want to play politics with it. And that's what you're up to. And I don't care whether you get the information off FOI. I don't care whether you wait 24 hours or 24 days. The fact that the Liberal Democrat lies in this city. You know the cheek of it. The fact is, we have to introduce fortnightly bin collections in this city. Why? Why did we do it? Why did we have to do it? Because of the Liberal Democrat cuts when they were in government. That's why we had to do it. We all know what the Liberal... You're desperate desperate to try and cling on to your seat and win votes for the Liberal Democrats, and desperate measures are required by you to do it, but I won't let you continue, or your party continue, to lie to the people of this city without checking and making sure that they get all the facts.
Councillor Kemp, we're not going to have this. It's not a question time for... No, there was questions to the Mayor on his statements, and I think that's what we're on now. Councillor Crone, have you indicated that you'd like to ask a question, or are you going to withdraw that?
Yeah, I will. Thank you, Lord Mayor. In the agenda here, in the Lord Mayor's note, it just says, are there any questions from members? So it's not regarding the statement, but it's on an issue that I think is quite important.
It's on the statement from the Mayor.
So I can't ask questions regarding open
question time,
issues
no.
that arose from the Mayor's case in Statutory High School there, no.
Councillor Mumby.
Mayor, I hate to make your blood pressure rise even more, but can I ask you to cast your mind back on the question of bins, to sitting in a budget working group with Councillor Mike Storey, who proposed that we move to a fortnightly bin collection service, and then put out a leaflet about 3 weeks later saying Labour plans to introduce a fortnightly bin. Yeah, he moved it, and then put out a leaflet denouncing like the rest of us for it. And then I believe he lost his seat just afterwards.
Yeah. All right, I mean, I think that we have, obviously, we get the drift, and obviously... we are going to move on now. Can I move on to item 10, which there's no changes in committee membership or appointments to outside bodies. There are no constitutional issues, so we're going to move on now to motions for debate. And can I remind members that in terms of the timing of speeches, the mover of the motion gets 5 minutes and has the right of reply 5 minutes. All other speakers 3 minutes and 2 minutes for extensions if agreed by the council. And we have had notice of an emergency motion moved by Mayor Anderson, seconded by Councillor Rotherby.
Motion in my name, Lord Mayor, and reserve my right.
I second it.
I'm grateful because this is very topical. And I thought I thought the contribution from the Police and Crime Commissioner was very, very informative and very effective. And I'm grateful that she had the opportunity to come to the council. Can I just ask one thing? It's mainly only minor drafting amendments.
Lord Mayor, can I just raise a point of order? I'd like to speak to the motion as a second. Second to the motion.
Can't speak after Councillor Radford will call you.
And I'm just wondering, and forgive me if I didn't get a copy to circulate and suggest earlier. In the Mayor's motion, which I'm broadly supportive of, although I would actually prefer the powers to remain with the Police and Crime Commissioner, I think there is a balance of merit there. It refers to oppose all forms of racial hatred. I'm wondering if the Lord Mayor would be minded all forms of hate against all forms of hate crime. Now, the reason I'm saying that, if there was a specific march aimed at the gay community, a specific march aimed at Christians, a specific march to the religious group, I would hope we would apply the same standards of incitement of hatred, not just narrowly in the field of racial crimes. And the reason I say that is, if we be candid, there has been a couple of demonstrations and groups of a religious nature who have attacked other religions and particularly gay community in the East of London. So I'm wondering if the Lord Mayor and other members would be minded to extend oppose all forms of hate crime rather than just specifically race to hate crime. And I think that would be a better context for debate and would actually make the enforcement easier as well, because then you can get into a discussion over what is hate crime or not. However, I will be supporting the amendment by Councillor Kemp, because I think if we are going to defend decisions made, I would have thought it would be more effective and more informed judgments made by the Police and Crime Commissioner with the support of the police making those judgment calls. But both are worthy, and I thank the Mayor for bringing this to our attention.
Councillor Rothery.
I'd just say I'd like to speak to the motion, please, Lord Mayor. The events of the last couple of months have been an unwarranted attack on the civil liberties of human rights and the ability to walk the streets of Liverpool without being insulted or fearful of attack. We know that the people of Liverpool are always ready to rally to defend our liberty and protect the vulnerable members of this city. But there must, why must our citizens be placed constantly in a precarious position and at risk of assault and having to police against the fascists when they come to the city? Our forefathers fought long and hard to protect our freedoms and to ensure that we live in a safe environment, free from tyranny, and yes, to ensure we live in a democracy where freedom of speech ensures we will never succumb to the fascists or the tyrannical regimes. We had to go to war and bomb the fascists to protect our citizens and communities in the past. We don't want to bomb the fascists today, as some people may have suggested in the past. We merely want to stop them from peddling their vile, misguided, divisive beliefs on our streets. Liverpool wants to make a stand to oppose these marches, protect our people and our way of life, and to encourage the growth of a city that is renowned for defending the vulnerable, challenging bigots and upholding our civil rights, adhering to our laws on the Race Relations Act. I so argue we are trying to ban freedom of speech and say that if Hitler had been opposed and his murderous ideologies challenged at the time, we would not have seen the gas, people sent to the gas chambers, shot and maimed in their millions. Hitler started in a back room with a handful of people. He went on challenged and went on to subject millions to the most heinous torture and murder. We need not to underestimate the fascists. If left unchallenged, they will go on to do the same if allowed to. If laws and processes and procedures fail us, we must bring about change, double our efforts and change our policies and procedures and laws. Also, can I also add that we have a number of things at our disposal and they need to be explored. And I know that legal challenges are very vague in some instances. And I know that we also have to protect our freedoms and our right to freedom of speech. But may I just say that I think we should be considering invoking the laws that are at our disposal at the moment under the Human Rights and Race Relations Act in terms of incitement to racial hatred, to clearly define the difference between what a march is and a demonstration, as there are different laws that look after it and that determine both of these events. And if needs be, we need to challenge process and procedures and indeed the existing laws to ensure that protection for our citizens. We also need to send out a strong message from Liverpool that we will not tolerate some scenes of this nature, and we will deal swiftly with those who come to this city to incite racial hatred. Thank you.
I have notice of an amendment by Councillor Richard Kemp. Is it seconded?
Seconded.
Would you like to move it now?
Thank you very much, my Lord Mayor. First of all, I would like to thank Joe Anderson for putting this resolution forward. This is a matter of absolute principle, as far as I'm concerned, and I'm sure there are two things which totally unite this council. Firstly, that there is no room for fascism on the streets of Liverpool. And the second thing is that if anything is to be done about them, if any decisions are made about what is acceptable or unacceptable, those decisions should be made here in Liverpool by people who know the city, know what is acceptable, and know what can be done. I'm sure also that none of us would ever disagree
with a peaceable demonstration, even if we didn't agree with the purposes of those demonstrators or the messages that those demonstrators have. We all in a democracy have a right to express our viewpoint, providing we do it in a way that is respectful of the law and is respectful of the opinions of others. That was not what happened on the streets of Liverpool last Saturday. What happened was people who are inarticulate, unable to express their opinions, to which very, very, very few people in Liverpool would listen, came here for the sole purpose of gaining publicity, and the only way that they and their brethren in BNP can do it is to try and cause a fight, to cause trouble, to maximise mayhem in the city. And I don't think I've said anything so far which anyone here would disagree with. But I come to a slightly different conclusion about the way we should deal with it, which I put into the amendment. First of all, the situation is rather unclear as to what we mean by an elected mayor in this case. It is quite possible that by this time next year we will have voted as a council to get rid of the elected mayor for Liverpool, and we will have a regional elected, a city region elected mayor. Why is it that we look for powers for an elected mayor when perhaps the leader of Leeds Council would also like to have the same powers? Because no one's going to pass a power which just deals with the circumstances of Liverpool. Now, I don't approve of elected police commissioners, my Lord Mayor, but we've got them. And the fact is, as we saw today, when a police matter was discussed, then we asked, in an unprecedented way, which I think was absolutely right, the elected police commissioner to come here and talk to us and respond to the people of Liverpool about it. So I think that decision should be delegated, should be given rather, to the elected police commissioner, and she would exercise that on the advice of the chief constable. And that wouldn't be just whether we liked or didn't like what the protesters were saying. There would really be two grounds, both of which would have applied last Saturday. The first is that the march or demonstration, and I accept the points that Councillor Rothery were making, and in fact the Mayor made in his earlier comments about the need to clarify the legalities of some of these issues, but where this was clearly designed to produce violence or damage, all the buildings, the fabric of our city, that would be a reason for rejecting it. The other one would be, we heard so much from the police commissioner about the costs of doing it. Costs that, if necessary, must be found if we're to protect the city of Liverpool. But there isn't a single person in this room, there isn't a single citizen of Liverpool who wouldn't believe that there was better ways to spend police time, or indeed public money, than policing a bunch of yobs on a Saturday coming here to try and cause problems. So that would be the second ground on which we would do it. My Lord Mayor, I don't think the government is anxiously awaiting this resolution, amended or unamended. So if you don't accept this, I will vote for the original motion because I believe that it's right in principle to do so. But I hope that you will seriously consider this amendment because it's trying to improve and build on this motion in a way which will have traction around the rest of the country and perhaps, perhaps, might just get a little bit more support from the government when we ask them to take the action which at this stage only they can make. My Lord Mayor, I beg to move.
Councillor Squirrell, we're on the amendment. Would you like to speak to the amendment or...
No,
anyone would like to speak? Councillor Oakes on the amendment?
Thank you, Lord Mayor.